Right, good evening, everyone. We are meeting again for our subject EGD. Today we are starting a new topic. Right, it's under the concept loci, but in particular, we are going to look at the helix. Itself in terms of the helix, and in particular, we are going to look at a situation whereby you have got transparent and non-transparent cylinders. Right, the content for today's lesson is as follows. Like I said, we have got the loci, we have got the helix. Right, we are going to look at the definition of these terms. In particular, what is it that we are looking at when we say locus or loci in plural terms? Then we've got the helix, right, which can also be referred to as helices if there are many. Then we have got terms that are used in the concept of the helix, which are helical terminology, right? Like I said, we are going to look at transparent and non-transparent cylinder. We are going to look at the hand, that is the left hand and the right hand. We are also looking at the tails, right? In looking at the number of revolutions, then the pitch also defined according to the concept of helix. Then we also want to touch on many applications of the helix. So for today's lesson, we are going to have a bit of talking rather than doing, but I hope we'll be able to define and construct a helix, both under transparent as well as non-transparent. I hear and I forget, I see and I remember, I do and I understand. That is our motto. So I want to make sure that we remain as practical as possible in terms of our approach to this subject. You have to do it in order to understand the subject. So let's hope you are going to enjoy today's lessons as we look at the concept of locus as well as the helix. Enjoy the lesson. Right, there you go. Right, so at the end of the day, we want to look at the construction of a helix. But before we look at that, like I said, right, I want us to look at the terms which are associated with what we refer to as the helix. Right, I did not come up with a PowerPoint. I want to explain so that you are able to see what is it that we are looking at with regards to the helix as well as the locus, okay? Right, when you see this word, right, loci, like that. Now, the singular part of it is to do with locus, okay? Right, so when we are looking at the locus of a point, right, basically this is the path which is followed by the movement of a point under defined conditions. Right, so if point A or point P has to move from A to B, right, under specific followed by the movement of point P from A to B, from B to C, is the locus, right? So the locus, basically, when we are looking at the term locus, we are looking at the path. So this is basically the path followed by a point as in a defined way. Okay, right. I want you to feel my explanation in terms of the concept and in terms of our focus of discussion. The path followed by a point as it moves in a defined way. Okay, right. So you would have guidelines in terms of the movement of point. You would have certain parameters that are guiding you in terms of the movement of a point. And we refer to this one, the locus. So basically, if you hear someone talking in scientific terms with regards to the locus, basically it is the path. Right. Then the other thing that we want to look at is this concept, the helix. Okay. Now, remember, we are looking at a helix, right, as an offshoot of the movement, which is the path, right? So the helix is defined as the locus of a point, right, which moves around and along the surface of a cylinder, okay? Right, now we know, we are now going to use the word locus, locus of a point, which moves around and along the surface of a cylinder. Okay. All right. So remember, we said that locus is the path, right? But when we define that path is movement of a point, right, around and along the surface of a cylinder, right? When it is around, right, let me just clarify this, around, you are talking about, right, that is the axial motion, okay, which means around, okay, right, going around certain thing, right, then you have got along, right, it describes the longitudinal, okay, longitudinal movement, okay, right, movement along, okay, it defines the gap or the length which has been defined in terms of movement, okay, right, from point A to point B. Right. Now, I indicated this, right, this concept, which is our cylinder, right, the cylinder. I introduced that term when we said that the locus of a point which moves around and along the surface of a cylinder. Now, in my introduction, I spoke about transparent and non-transparent, okay? Right, so when we are talking about, right, transparent cylinder, right, remember, we said that the helix is the locus of a point or the path of a point which moves around and along the surface of a cylinder. Right, so if that cylinder is a see-through, right, you are able to see from one end to the other, right, you are able to see through it, right, which means it is transparent, okay? Right, whether the point is at the bottom, but because you are able to see through the cylinder, we say it is transparent, okay? Right, then when it is non-transparent, which means it's opaque, you are not able to see through that. So it's basically the opposite of transparent, okay? So when it is transparent and with regards to the concept of a helix, right, you are able to see through it. What it means, the path can be defined, whether it is at the bottom or at the top, you are still going to see the path of that helix, which the path of a point which we define as the helix. Okay, right, so that's about the transparent and non-transparent with regards to the cylinder. There are also other terminologies that we use with regards to with regards to the helix, okay? Right, you talk about the hand, right? When you are looking at the helix, right, we are going to talk about right hand, we are going to talk about left hand, right? Let me look at right hand, right? Remember we said that in terms of movement, right, of a point around and along the surface of a cylinder, right? So if the point is moving away from you, but going to the right, right? Would you define that one as right hand, okay? But if it is moving and round the cylinder and you are able to see it when it is going to the left, we say it's left-handed, okay? Right, so right hand, right, like this, which would normally shortened as this, okay? Right, in terms of plotting of points, we say the right hand, it would move in a clockwise direction, okay? Right, clockwise direction, that's very important to note. So right hand, right, moving around and along the surface of a cylinder, moving away from you, but making sure that the outlined parts of that path, which we refer to as the helix, right, when it is going to the right, is outlined, then we say it is right hand. So in other terms, you find that it's rising and moving away from you and going to the right, okay? And if the outlined path is the one which is going to the right, then we say it is a right hand. Then you would find that we also have got the left hand, which would be shortened like this, right? And this is also noted as being anti-clockwise, okay? Right, that is, it's rising to the left, okay? Right, remember what I said from the beginning, right? Our subject, it thrives on being practical. So some of the terms that we are looking at right now, right, you'd find that they would make sense when we actually draw that helix, okay? Then the other terms that we want to look at, right, is the issue of tens, okay? Right, when we are talking about tens in the helix, in the concept of the helix, we are basically saying that as it rotates around the surface of the cylinder, right, how many tens does it make, which can also be referred to as revolutions, right? So the tens are basically the number of times you'll be able to see the point as it goes around the surface of a cylinder, okay? Sometimes it will turn halfway, sometimes it will turn once, sometimes it will turn twice, right? So if we are looking at a cylinder like this, right, you have got a center line like that, the point would start here, so it is moving like that. Then if it is non-transparent, it would hide, then it would come back to a similar. So if this is point zero, this would also be point zero. Then it starts again, maybe it stops here, okay? Right, so you'd find that if we outline this like that, then make this one hidden like that, automatically when you see something like that, then we outline again, right, which is the path which is followed by the point, right? This one would signify that it is a left hand, because going to the left, it's outlined. Even if you are standing from that side, it would move away from you and go to the left, okay? When this is outlined, you know it is left hand, okay? Now, so what we are talking about, the tail from this point back to this point, the point would have gone one turn, which is one complete revolution. Now, I'm going to do this, right, like that. Now, we are saying that the movement around, but remember, it's not only moving around at one point, it is moving around and along the surface like that, okay? So it's moving from here and there. Now you'd find that it is now here, so it would have gone 1 turn and a half. If it goes back like that, it will be 2 turns, okay? All right, now you'd find that as the point is moving from here to there, okay? Right, it would cover a distance like this. The distance from one point to a similar point, right, in 1 turn, right, is what we refer to as the pitch. That is the longitudinal distance, okay? Right, this one, which goes around like that, that is the axial distance, okay? So it goes around, right, to create a turn. It moves along to create a pitch, okay? Right, so these are the terms that we would come across as we are looking at the concept of a helix, okay? Right, I have explained this one. If I were to create another sketch like this, like that, then I still have got point zero, right? Then this one would move like that, then comes back like this, then move like that, then comes back like this. Right, then if I outline this one like that, then show this other as a hidden detail, outline this one like that, then show this one as a hidden detail like that. Right, this is going to the right, whether I'm standing from this side or I'm standing from this side, because this is zero, this is zero, okay? Which is the starting point. So from here to there, we said that would give us the pitch, okay? That would give us the pitch. Right, the distance from one point to another similar point at the start of another turn or another revolution is what we refer to as a pitch, okay? Right, the movement around a cylinder from one point to a similar point at the start of another turn is what we refer to as, right, a revolution or a turn, okay? Right, so you would find that in terms of the turns and the pitch, right, these are interrelated, okay? Right, because for you to come up with a turn, you need to move a distance along, okay, which we refer to as the pitch. Right. I think I have looked basically at some of the terms which are key in describing the concept of the helix. Remember, we said that the helix, right, it is the path which is followed by a point as it moves around and along the surface of a cylinder. We also defined the concept of locus, which is the path itself, which is followed by a point, okay? Then we looked at the hand, right? We have got what we refer to as the right hand. In terms of plotting, especially with regards to the top view, we would plot it, right, in a clockwise direction, right? Left hand would plot it in anti-clockwise direction. But there are certain other considerations that we would need to make, right? We shall see these considerations as we start our work in terms of the drawing itself. Now, the other thing that we want to define before we look at this, well, we want to look at some of the applications, okay? All right, I'll write this, applications of the concept of the helix, okay? But you'll find that the helical concept is used widely in industry, right? In the manufactures of so many things, some to do with what we refer to as. Right, now if you have seen a drill and a drill, right, the application of the auger is similar to that. They also got chutes, right, as you are growing, right, from a tender age, from a young age, you go to a park, right, they are sliced there, right. That is one example or one application of how chutes could be defined, but they could also be used in providing with regards to ceilings and in extraction pipes, and you would also have got what we refer to as chutes, okay? Right, then you also have got springs, right? They are also constructed and designed as a result of using the concept of, right, you also have got, right, you also have even the gear wheels, okay, gear systems, right, some of them, they are helical in terms of design, okay, right, then you have got spiral staircases, right? They are also as a result of applying the concept of the helix. So there are so many applications, right? You talk about threads, right? Screws, right? Screw threads and so forth. Right? These are basically as a result of applying of the helix. So as we look at the concept of the helix, as we come up with drawings related to the helix, okay, you would find that you would see the real application, okay, of this at work. But I hope this brief background with regards to the concept of the helix, right, opened your mind as to what is it that we are going to do and what is it today. Right, I want you to enjoy the diagrams, the illustrations that we are going to make, right, as we look at of the helix. Let's start. Right, I would acknowledge, right, that I'm using HSE, that's the one that we normally use. Right, the given information, the front view of a transparent cylinder and the starting point of a helix, right? So remember what we talked about with regards to the helix. It's movement point around and along the surface of a cylinder. Right, and that movement is defined by the term locus, okay? If there are many, that's why we talk about loci, okay? Right, specification, the direction is left-handed, right? Remember we said left-handed, it's anti-clockwise. Then turns, right? The number of revolutions that the point is going to make around the surface of the cylinder is, okay? Right, starting at point at A, draw to scale 1:1, the helix and the cylinder, okay? Show all necessary construction. Now, we are given here, right, this one is the shaft or cylinder itself. That is when we are looking at, right, the auger, such applications as the tube, right, where you have got the shaft, but in this case we are basically looking at it as a cylinder. We want to define the concept of a helix, okay? Right, we have got from here to there, that's diameter 50. We are going to do, right, at this point I would draw, right, a faint line like that. Right, if you check on the right hand, right, if you check here, right, you find that it's basically the same, right, you have got diameter 50, right, and the height is also 90, okay, but let us complete this one first, then we go to the second one, right in the middle. Faintly. Right, diameter 50, which is radius 25.
radius 25. I'm going to draw a circle. Radius 25, like that. Let me just check if I will be able to fit 90, but if I start here, there you go. Right. So the distance from here to there, that's 90. Then I will take this one. Yes. Outline this. The next thing, I need to define the center lines. So we have got the ceiling, okay? Right, that is the top view. The moment you see something like this in EGD, whereby the top view is at the top, you know you are dealing with orthographic projection, right? And instead angle orthographic projection, in terms of our examinations, that's paper two, okay? Right, we have got point A, which is here, right? So I'm going to label this point and say this is point A, but also I would say that is point zero, okay? Right. Then we need to divide this circle into 12 equal parts. Okay. Like that, okay. Now, if the point is starting at the top in terms of its movement, remember we said that if it is left-handed, right, it is anti-clockwise. If the point is starting at the top like that, you maintain the hand that is given in terms of the labels that you are going to have here, right? So if it is anti-clockwise like that, that's clockwise. If it goes like this, it's anti-clockwise. If it is starting at the bottom, right, you reverse the hand here, okay? I would explain that to come across that situation, okay? So I'm going to say this is point one, this is point two, this will be point three, this will be point six, this point nine, right? So that we don't waste the time, right, labeling everything, right? We can see the floor, that's one, two, three, four, five, six, like that, okay? Right, once you have divided this one into 12 equal parts, for 110, you are also going to have 12 divisions. So if it is two like this, right, which means you need 24 divisions, okay? Right, I'm going to draw a line here. Draw a line like that, faintly, just as a construction line. You can use a compass to divide. If we check with our, we'll take a compass, open a convenient radius, but in this case, right, I'm just going to use 5 millimeter divisions like this. There you go. Then connect this one to there. Right, in an exam, this is a mark. The division like that, you'll get a mark for dividing the side into a number of equal parts. Right, I'm going to use an adjustable set screen. Like this, then project. There you go. But those are the divisions. Then I'm going to make them straight like that. Right, okay. Right, so now I've got the cylinder, which is divided into 24 equal parts, okay? Remember, 1 10 is 12 divisions, okay? So if it is half a 10, you'll find that you have got 6 divisions. If it is 2 10s, right, you have got 24, okay? Right, but it also depends with the number made there, okay? If you made divisions, but for one complete 10 also here, you need 6 divisions. For 2 complete 10s, you need 12 divisions, okay? Right, the next thing, right, is to bring these lines down, right, faintly. Like that. Right. Now you can also label here, this is your point zero, then 1 2 3 4 5 6 1 2 4 5 6, then you say 7 8 9 10 11 12, which is 0, which is 1 10, which is our pitch, right? 1 2 3 4 5 6, right? That's half 10. 1 2 3 4 5 6, that's another 0. Okay, so from 0 to 0, that's 1 10. From 0 to 0, that's another 10. From 0 to 6, that's half a 10, right? Or also to half the pitch. Now the thing that you, right, once your divisions are equal, 12 here, and you have got also 12, it is 1 10, and 24 if it is 2 10s. Right, now you coordinate, this is point one, this would be one, so it's 1, right, 2 then 3 4 5 and 6, which is a half a 10, 7 8 9 10, 11, 12, which is one complete 10. Then you start again. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. Okay, right. Once we have done that, you connect this point, these points. There you go. Right, so we have got this profile, okay? Right, the point is moving from point A, this is our point A, like that. It's moving from here, that's point A, right, like that. So it's moving around the surface, but also along, up until it completes the full length of the cylinder. And this path that has been completed, since it is transparent, okay, we are going to see the path, whether it is on the other side, you still be able to see that. So what you would do is, you would outline this now. Yes. Remember, when you are outlining, especially if it is freehand, you now correct even these small mistakes that would have made in terms of your faint construction lines. I would also maybe start from here. Right, eye coordination is very critical in an exercise like this, okay? See where you are coming from, but at the same time, see where you are going. Now, boys and girls, this is what we refer to as the helix, the movement of a point around and along the surface of a cylinder. That is what we refer to as the helix, okay? Right, and if it is on a transparent a cylinder like this, you are able to see the path, okay? But don't be too excited. You'll never be asked to draw just a helix like this. You'll be asked to apply the concept of a helix in an examination, okay? But the basis of that application is what we've just completed right now. Now, I'm going to relate what we have done right onto the right-hand side, so that we look now at a situation when the cylinder is non-transparent, okay? But the front view of a non-transparent cylinder and the starting point A, right? As you can see, our point A is at the bottom, right? What I want to do, I want to use these same constructions here, okay? But applied this side. Right, so I'm going to start by drawing a line right in the middle, like that, just a faint line, right? Take the measurements from here, same divisions, right? I'm going to draw a faint line like that. Then I'm going to just redraw this from here because the specifications are basically the same. Draw a circle like this. Okay, so that we will be able to get from there, right? Just these ones like that, okay? Right, I just want you to see that we are transferring the divisions from here. We are not going to do the same process that we did. So it's just transferring them to this side, okay? I'm going to bring this going to outline this. Also show the center line. There you go. Also outline this. So this cylinder is the same as that one, but that one was transparent. But I'm going to borrow from here the same divisions, like this. There you go. Okay. So the divisions which are here are now there as well. But remember, in an examination, in a test, you need this construction in order for you to get a mark for this division. Okay. Right. If you don't do that, you may need to calculate, say, 90 divided by 24. Right. You would find that in some cases, you may not get an even number. Right. So if you have got 90, divided by 24, right, is 3.75. That won't give you an even number. So you may not even measure from here to there. 3.75 is going to be difficult. So they want you to graphically show, right, the division like this, okay? Right, in terms of the height of the cylinder. But here, in order to save time, because I've already demonstrated here, the divisions can now just be transferred. Right, okay. I'm also going to divide this one into 12 equal parts. There you go. Okay. Right. So I have got my divisions both in the top view as well as in the front view. But remember, this is my point A. Point A is my point zero as well, okay? Right, so that's point A, and which is also point zero, okay? Right, now there's something that is slightly different to the first one, right? If a point is starting at the bottom, right, in terms of numbering, we know that the hand that we are using is the right hand, which is supposed to be clockwise like that, right? But you are looking from this point, right? In terms of the movement of the point, you are looking here, right? So if it is starting at the bottom, what you do is you reverse the hand, which is here, okay? Right, we know if it is right hand, it's clockwise. This point is starting at the bottom, so I'm going to number this one anti-clockwise. So this will be my point 1, 3, 6, 9 back to zero, like that, okay? Such that if the wheel is turned, okay? Right. The first point that you will be able to see through this point, okay, or through this direction, or from this direction, is point number one, then point number two, and point number three, moving in a clockwise direction, okay? So the reason why you change the direction if the point is starting at the bottom is to make sure that you are able to see the movement of points according to the hand, okay, which is clockwise like that. Now, once you have done that, you now bring those lines. Let me just take this one. I can start from here, it's fine. Project up. This one is already in. There you go. Okay. Right. So these are vertical projections. The horizontal projections are there. And we are also making an assumption that there is the division, which is done here. Okay. Right. Now, point zero is here. It's starting at the bottom. So we are going to say point zero. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 6 is here. 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, which is 0.0. But so from here to there, that's a complete 10. But then from here, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We have got another half 10, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, which is 0.0. Okay. So the point would move along the surface of the cylinder as well as around the cylinder. But I hope you are following this, because as we move forward, we will basically make use of the concept that we are looking at right now, today, okay? In terms of the generation of the other applications that would look at, like the auger, like the chute, like the spring, right? Like the threads and so forth, remember? So we would make use of the concept of a helix, okay? It might come out differently from what we are doing right now, but the basic underlying concept would remain the same. So I'm going to note, this is point one, that's point two, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Then 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 0. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 0. Like that. Right. Then the next thing, you join these points nicely. Faintly at first. There you go. That is just about the framework, okay? Now, once you have done this, right, in terms of the helix, okay? Right, you look again at the hand. Remember we said this one is non-transparent, which means we are not going to see. You outline the helix, which is going to the right, right? You outline that part of the helix which is going to the right, and in this case, if you look at this, this is moving away from me, but it's rising to the left, but this one is rising to the right. So I'm going to outline this. Like that. But then there's another one, which is here, right? It's also going to the right. So I'm going to outline that. Remember what I said? Eye coordination is very important. But see where you are going, but also look at where you are coming from, okay? Right, the next one that we want to look at, right, is now this one, which is going to the left, okay? Right, because transparent, we are not able to see that, but even though we know that it is there, but we are unable to see it, so I'm going to show this one. Is a hidden detail. Yes, okay, but it's going to the left, so it's on the other side of the cylinder, it's not visible, so I would represent that movement as a hidden detail. The same applies with this one from here to there, but it has to be shown as a hidden detail. Here we go, okay. Right, so from here to there, rising to the left, right, which means it will be aside. I can only see it when it is here on my side, which means it's now rising to the right. The moment if this line was and this one was hidden, you would know that it's left hand, okay? So by virtue of an outline and a hidden detail like this, you know this is going to the right, it's going to the right, and therefore it is right hand. So that's where the issue of right hand comes. But one key concept that we also looked at, if the point is starting at the bottom of the cylinder like this, right, the labels in terms of the top view, they have to counter that hand, okay? What it means, basically, if it is right hand, you now anti-clockwise, okay? As if it's left hand. But if it is starting at the top, you maintain the hand, okay? The hand, so that you are not going to change the direction. So if this one was 3, 6, 9 and back to 0. But I need you to understand that in the determination of concept to do with loci, okay? Right, you'll find that we are still going to look at the chem, we are still going to look at mechanism. They basically make use of this concept that we are looking at in terms of numbering. Remember, the concept of loci is movement of a point at intervals, okay? You move, you stop, and check the position. Boys and girls, but this was just the background to what we want to look at in terms of applications of the helix. Like I said, you won't be asked a question just to draw a helix like this, but you'll be expected to apply the knowledge of the helix in order to solve a problem. I hope you enjoyed this lesson and I hope it was fruitful. You were able to get the concept right. So for today, we are going to end here and we'll meet again when we now look at the auger, when we now look at the chute in terms of the application of the helix. Good night.